Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
As soon as Jesus and the disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. Jesus came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." Jesus answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also. That is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So this is a pretty loaded passage. There's a lot going on. There's enough to do several weeks on it. Or maybe months. Maybe our whole lives. After all, there is something to Jesus teaching in the synagogue and then going home with them. Jesus goes home. I don't know if you've thought about that. Think about going about your work. Well, think about schoolwork, things you got to do in your neighborhood, in your town, stuff around, coming to church, then going home and Jesus goes with you. Have you thought about that? They introduce Jesus to Simon's mother-in-law, who unfortunately doesn't get a name in this story. But she's sick, and Jesus heals her. It says she's lifted up, which is the same phrase that's used when people are raised. She's raised up. She's given new life. Life is changed forever, having encountered Jesus. And she gets up and serves them. Now, there's been some note on that maybe she, like, served him lunch or something. Or maybe she just wanted to be a good mom and host. But there's a lot more than that. Because it's for all of us, whenever we encounter Jesus in our lives, whenever we are lifted up, raised up to new life, and whatever that means for us, whether it's getting rid of our guilt and shame and being forgiven, whether it's being healed in a real and personal way, whether it's having our demons cast out, whatever that means, we're changed. And the response is to serve, to share, just as Jesus shares love with us. Have you thought about what it might cost them to follow Jesus? Because I hadn't thought about that really in this text until I reread it again. That Simon, at least, is identified as having a family. He was a fisherman, and he left that to follow Jesus. Have we thought about what it costs us to follow Jesus? Well, it says the demons were cast out. And actually, before that, it says they were silenced. They weren't allowed to speak even, because they knew Jesus. Now, from what I understand, Cassie did a great job last week of talking about that and even sharing her own experience around that. I don't have much to add. I don't know what the demonic is, really. But all I can say is it's probably those things that keep us from God. Or it's the things that trap us from being who God calls us to be. Or it's the evil that we know that's out there in the world that somehow draws us into it. And those forces are not even allowed to speak in the presence of Jesus. What might it mean for us to live our lives of faith in the presence of Jesus, knowing that evil isn't even allowed to speak? Thought about that. Then they bring all these people. The whole city gathers. The whole city. They gather at the door. And we're told that Jesus does what Jesus does. He heals them. He casts those demons aside. And then it's the next day. Now you would expect there's a lot for Jesus to do. Probably didn't get to everybody that night. People are still all lined up. But where's Jesus? He's in a deserted place where he went by himself to pray. And I can speak personally, I need to learn from this as a person that often burns the candle at both ends. We can't do everything. Maybe we can pick. But then he does something really fascinating, which is where I want to spend the rest of our time this morning, is thinking about what he does next. Because they find him, and everyone's been searching for you, Jesus. But he says, let us go on to the surrounding towns and proclaim the message there also. And that's what I came out to do. And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message and casting out demons. So what's that about? Jesus knows his mission. It's to go to the surrounding towns. It's to proclaim the message. And what is that message? If you were to read back in Mark a few verses prior, he says, repent and believe the good news, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And what that looks like in people's lives is forgiveness and healing and the casting out of demons. So not only does he know his mission and his message, he also knows how to measure it, which is fascinating. Let us go to the surrounding towns. He doesn't want to set up shop there. He probably could have done that. Spent a long time in that town, healing and casting out demons and proclaiming the good news. But that's not why he came. And these stories that Mark tells are all about going to those other places and encountering people. Often when he heals them, he will say, don't tell anybody about it, which might sound weird to us. But I think it's because he wants to keep going. He wants to keep spreading the news and sharing his message. And he can't do that if he's cooped up in one place. So that's something for us to think about. What is the message and our mission, and how might we measure that? Well, often, when we think about church and we think about the measurements that we take, we often do the same things. So we're having our annual meeting next week, and we've got our annual report prepared, and it's full of information. Will tell you the things that we keep track of, like how many people we have in worship each week, and whether or not we met our budget, and other things, too. And so we use those as those markers that we kind of keep track of things. But maybe those are not the best things to keep track of. I mean, they certainly tell a story, but do they tell anything about our lives being changed? Do they tell anything about Jesus lifting us up? Do they say anything about what it means for us to live as faithful people in the world where evil is silenced in Jesus' presence? I'm not so sure. So last week I was in Houston for a conference. The first end of that is I was getting ready for the ELCA Youth Gathering, which is going to be in Houston next year. But the second half of the time I was there was for this big conference. They have a youth ministry conference every year, and Lutherans are always good at naming things. It's the ELCA Youth Ministry Network. It's not actually a program of the church. It started by a few youth ministry people who decided they wanted to get extra support for the work they were doing, and they could kind of self-organize around that. So in the mid-90s, they said, well, why don't we get together and have a gathering? And the point of it is we're going to have some continuing ed and fellowship, and we can network together. But really, it's about support for the work that we do. So they knew their mission, and they knew their message, and they knew how to measure it. And so that's what they did. And I've been to a lot of continuing ed events, and I've been to a lot of conferences. But I will tell you, this was not like most things I've been to. And I shared a little bit of this in my note of introduction for Cassie last week. So we're all in this room. There's about 1,000 people in this space. A lot of them are youth directors, but also pastors and professors and camp directors and you know people that work in this field. And excellent speakers, just very, very well done. Workshops were great. Met some old friends, met some new friends, hit all those marks. But this was the thing that was, to me, the most amazing. And so they called all the new people up. Like, if you've been in ministry less than a year, which there were varying ages of folks, but it was mostly like first jobs out of college. That's the majority of them. all gathered up front. They also gathered some experienced people behind them to lay hands on them, like what we do when we have like confirmation or something like that. And Bishop Mike Reinhardt, who's the bishop in Houston, came up and he talked to them specifically and prayed for them. And then they turned around and everybody welcomed them. And it was just really, really affirming. I said, we need to do this, church. This is great. And then as the weekend went on, it added. So then they had, the next day, they had anybody who had been in ministry 10 years or less stand up, and then everybody clapped, and they got a little cross. And then said, anybody who's been in ministry 10 years or more, stand up, and get a gold cross. I got mine on my collar. Just be claps for everybody. And then they said, everybody, this was another time, anybody who has been in ministry 25 years or more, and they came up. And then they had the people who had come up before them come up again and lay hands on them and pray for them and turn around. And we had like a standing ovation for minutes. It was really wonderful. I said, yeah, Marcia's into this. We got to do this. This is great. I said, aha, that's a good thing to measure. Nobody asked about budgets or people. It was, can you hang in there? Do you have wisdom to share? Can you support each other? Can we affirm what God is doing while standing in the midst of us? Those are some pretty good measurements around mission and message. But then I went to several workshops, but one workshop I wanted to go into in particular because it was the speaker we had at our last Synod Assembly, whose name is Peggy Pond, who leads a group called LEAD, which is an acronym for Living Every Day as Disciples. There's an extra letter in there, I'm not sure how that works. But her presentation at Synod Assembly last year talked about seeking out better measurements. Can we think about better metrics to actually figure out if we're doing the ministry we're called to do? And while she was talking last year at Synod Assembly, she said, well, what if you were, if one of your goals was to build community together? And my ear perked up because I thought, aha, that sounds like our mission statement, to build community in Christ and serve Christ in community. And she said, what if you didn't think about how many people were in worship that day, but you thought about, did people stick around for snacks? Or what about the peace? Or what about, and I like to joke about this, at this service, shoo people into worship because we're too busy catching up out there. I mean, we like being together. I mean, think of the ministry that we do and all the little places that we do it, that it's foundational around the community that we're building together and how joyful that is. Maybe we can measure that. What's the mission? What's the message? What can we measure? So this morning I had you write on that little card, if you did it, how you might describe this church. Again, keeping in mind, it's not about personalities, or it's not about specific programs, or it's not about just church jargon. It's just about your elevator speech with somebody new, and what is it about St. Paul? And you wrote something down. I'll read them later this week after you put them in the offer. Now, I'm willing to bet with our group here that everybody wrote down something different. Probably, right? We all have different experiences. We all have different things we gravitate towards. We're all individuals. We're all children of God. But wouldn't it be something if we worked on this for a while to where if we were asked what's our mission and our message and what are we measuring, we all came up with relatively the same kinds of things and we're moving in one direction. I think this is something we can work on. And I think Jesus shows us exactly the power of it. Because he could have stayed and done a million different other things, couldn't he? I mean, there were certainly people in need there, and there were certainly demons to be cast out. And yet, he knew his mission and his message and the way to measure it. Let us go to the surrounding towns so I might proclaim the message there also. And they did. And they did. So what I'd like to invite you to do is as you get your annual report to take home and read, or maybe you've looked at it online already, is to think about what you wrote down and read the report. When you read that report, think about what is it saying? What does it say about the mission that we share together in this place? What message are we trying to get across? And what might we measure to see if we're on track? And in the meantime, let's follow Jesus to those surrounding towns and see where he takes us next.